Greetings, YouTube. This is Brett Norman. I have Chapter 4, President Abraham Lincoln, of the book The Secret Terrorists by Bill Hughes. And this is a monumental chapter that I'm about to read to you. And I hope you enjoy it. And I hope you have the patience to sit through it with me and listen in, and feel free to download the book and read it for yourself as well. So, that being said, here we go. Chapter 4, President Abraham Lincoln. In 1856, a runaway slave named Dred Scott had sought to gain freedom in the free state of Kansas. The case was so important that it went all the way to the Supreme Court. The infamous Dred Scott decision was rendered by the fanatical Roman Catholic Judge Taney, the Chief Justice of the United States at that time. The Taney decision, in a nutshell, was that the Negro had no rights that the white man had to respect. This basically said that the black man was inferior to the white man and had no rights. Abraham Lincoln, as a child, had watched the selling of young black men and women in a small Illinois town. As he and a friend walked past a slave auction, Lincoln turned to his friend and said, quote, "Someday I'm going to hit it hard," unquote. In November of 1855, Charles Chiniqui, a Catholic priest of Kankakee, Illinois, had been attacked in a series of court cases by the Bishop of the Chicago Diocese. Since many of the priests were alcoholics and most of the others were social drinkers, Chiniqui's talks on temperance were not appreciated. Chiniqui often quoted the Bible in defense of certain positions he held. This greatly inflamed the Catholic Bishop of Chicago against him. In order to silence him, Chiniqui was framed, being accused of an immoral priest's female relative of misconduct towards her. Charles Chiniqui's case had been so publicized in the press that very few lawyers wanted to defend him. They realized that they were not just fighting against a priest in Chicago. They were fighting against the Roman Catholic Church. Charles Chiniqui learned of Abe Lincoln, a very loyal and upright lawyer in Illinois. Chiniqui sent Lincoln a wire asking for his services, and within 20 minutes of Chiniqui's wire, he got a reply that said, quote, "Yes, I will defend your life and your honor at the next May term of the court at Urbana, signed Abraham Lincoln," unquote. Chiniqui relates, quote, "The time arrived when the sheriff of Kankakee had to drag me again as a criminal and a prisoner to Urbana and deliver me into the hands of the sheriff of that city. I arrived there on the 20th of October with my lawyers, Messrs. Osgood and Paddock, and a dozen witnesses. Mr. Abraham Lincoln had preceded me only by a few minutes from Springfield," unquote. Charles Chiniqui, 50 years in the Church of Rome. When Charles Chiniqui was defended by Abraham Lincoln, we read, quote, "He went on and depicted the career of Father Chiniqui, how he had been unjustly persecuted, and in conclusion said, quote, "As long as God gives me a heart to feel, a brain to think, or a hand to execute my will, I shall devote it against that power which has attempted to use the machinery of the courts to destroy the rights and character of a American citizen." Unquote. And this promise made by Abraham Lincoln in his maturer years also he kept. Unquote. Burke McCarty, The Suppressed Truth About the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln realized that Chiniquy had been unjustly accused. The night before, Chiniquy was to be condemned to prison for a crime he did not commit. An eyewitness who had overheard the plot to destroy Chiniquy came forward as he was saved. Abraham Lincoln made a lot of enemies as a result of the Chiniquy trial. As they left the courtroom, Charles Chiniquy was in tears. Abraham Lincoln asked him, quote, "Father Chiniquy, what are you crying for?" Quote, "Dear Mr. Lincoln," unquote, I answered, quote, "allow me to tell you that the joy I should naturally feel for such a victory is destroyed in my mind by the fear of what it may cost you." There were in the court not less than 10 or 12 Jesuits from Chicago and St. Louis who came to hear my sentence of condemnation to the penitentiary. What troubles my soul just now and draws my tears is that it seems to me that I have read your sentence of death in their fiendish eyes. How many other noble victims have they already fallen at their feet? Unquote. Charles Chiniquy, 50 years in the Church of Rome. Abraham Lincoln, as far back as 1855 and 1856, was already a marked man that Rome sought to destroy. 4 years later, in 1860, and Abraham Lincoln was elected President of the United States. As he made his way from Illinois to Washington, D.C., he had to pass through the city of Baltimore. He later said to Charles Chiniquy, quote, "I am so glad to meet you again. You see that your friends, the Jesuits, have not yet killed me, but they would have surely done it when I passed through their most devoted city, Baltimore, had I not passed by incognito a few hours before they expected me. We have proof that the company which had been selected and organized to murder me was led by a rabid Roman Catholic called Byrne. It was almost entirely composed of Roman Catholics. More than that, there were two disguised priests among them to lead and encourage them. I saw Mr. Morse, the learned inventor of electric telegraphy. He told me that when he was in Rome not long ago, he found out the proofs of the most formidable conspiracy against this country and all its institutions. It is evident that it is to the intrigues and emissaries of the Pope that we owe in great part the horrible civil war, which is threatening to cover the country with blood and ruins. I am sorry that Professor Morse had to leave Rome before he could know more about the secret plans of the Jesuits against the liberties and the very existence of this country." Unquote. Quote, 20 men had been hired in Baltimore to assassinate the president-elect on his way to Washington. The leader of this band was an Italian refugee, a barber well known in Baltimore. Their plan was as follows. When Mr. Lincoln arrived in that city, the assassins were to mix with the crowd and get as near his person as possible and shoot him with their pistols. If he was in a carriage, hand grenades had been prepared filled with detonating power, such as orsini, used in attempting to assassinate Louis Napoleon. These were to be thrown into the carriage, and to make the work of death doubly sure, pistols were to be discharged into the vehicle at the same moment. The assassins had a vessel lying ready to receive them in the harbor. From thence, they would be carried to Mobile in the seceded state of Alabama, unquote. John Smith Dye, The Adder's Den. Quote, an Italian barber well known in Baltimore, a Romanist, was to have stabbed him while seated in his carriage when he started from the depot, unquote. Burke McCarty, The Suppressed Truth About the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Fortunately, the first plot of the Jesuits to kill Lincoln failed. As they sought to take Lincoln's life before he had reached the White House, while riding on a train, John Wilkes Booth dropped a letter written to him by Charles Selby. Shortly after, the letter was found and, quote, delivered to President Lincoln, who, after having read it, wrote the word assassination across it and filed it in his office, where it was found after his death and was placed in evidence as a court exhibit, unquote. Here is an excerpt from the letter, quote, Abe must die, and now. You can choose your weapons, the cup, the knife, the bullet. The cup failed us once and might again. You know where to find your friends. Your disguises are so perfect and complete. Strike for your home, strike for your country, bide your time, but strike sure, unquote. This letter was used to help convict Mrs. Mary E. Surratt and some of the other conspirators in the trials of the Lincoln assassination. They wanted to stab him. If that failed, they were to shoot him and blow him up. Those failed, so they tried to poison him. Quote unquote, they were the emissaries of the Pope, the Jesuits. John Smith Dye, who was a witness to these events, tells us, quote, it was a dark day in our country's history when an armed guard had to surround the hotel Willard's, where the chief magistrate had taken temporary lodging to prevent his assassination. And on the day, March 4, 1861, of his inauguration, he was escorted up Pennsylvania Avenue in a hollow square of cavalry, and the utmost vigilance was exercised by General Scott to prevent his being publicly assassinated on the way to the Capitol to deliver his inaugural address from the East Portico. These were terrible times, unquote. John Smith Dye, The Adder's Den. When you remember the Council of Vienna, Metternich, the Pope, and the Jesuit Order's plans to destroy this country, to destroy its freedom, to destroy Protestantism, and to kill presidents, what does that tell you about the evil, vicious, malicious character of the Jesuits? When you remember their attempts on Andrew Jackson's life, the assassination of William Henry Harrison, the assassination of Zachary Taylor, the attempted assassination of James Buchanan, the attempted assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and then finally his assassination, what does that tell you about the Catholic Church? It shows you that their facade of being a church is just that, a facade. They hide behind a religious mask so that they will not be suspected of many abominations they may continually perpetrate in this country and around the world. May God help us to never have anything to do with this satanic organization. Abraham Lincoln stated, quote, "So many plots have already been made against my life that it is a real miracle that they have all failed when we consider that the great majority of them were in the hands of the skillful Roman Catholic murderers, evidently trained by Jesuits. But can we expect that God will make a perpetual miracle to save my life? I believe not. The Jesuits are so expert in those deeds of blood that Henry IV said it was impossible to escape them. And he had become their victim, though he did all that could be done to protect himself. My escape from their hands, since the letter of the Pope to Jeff Davis has sharpened the million of daggers to pierce my breast, would be more than a miracle." Unquote. Quote, "But just as the Lord heard no murmur from the lips of Moses when he told him that he had to die before crossing the Jordan for the sins of his people, so I hope and pray that he will hear no murmur from me when I fall for my nation's sake. The only two favors I ask of the Lord are, first, that I may die for the sacred cause in which I am engaged, and that I am the standard bearer of the rights and liberties of my country. The second favor I ask of God is that my dear son Robert, when I am gone, will be one of those who lift up the flag of liberty which will cover my tomb and will carry it with honor and fidelity to the end of his life as his father did, surrounded by the millions who will be called with him to fight and die for the defense to honor our country." Unquote. Charles Chiniquy, 50 years in the Church of Rome. Abraham Lincoln understood that his time was near. Quote, "In the midst of unparalleled success, while all the bells of the land were ringing with joy, a calamity fell upon us, which overwhelmed the country in consternation and awe. On Friday evening, April 14, President Lincoln attended Ford's Theater in Washington. He was sitting quietly in his box listening to the drama when a man entered the door of the lobby leading to the box, closing the door behind him. Drawing near to the president, he drew from his pocket a small pistol and shot him in the back of the head. As the president fell senseless and mortally wounded, and the shriek of his wife, who was seated at his side, pierced every ear, the assassin leaped from the box a perpendicular height of 9 feet. And as he rushed across the stage, bareheaded, brandished a dagger, exclaiming, 'Sic semper tyrannis,' and disappeared behind the scenes. Noble Abraham, true descendant of the father of the faithful, honest in every trust, humble as a child, tender-hearted as a woman, who he could not bear to injure even his most envenomed foes, who in the hour of triumph was saddened lest the feelings of his adversaries should be wounded by their defeat, with the charity for all, malice towards none, endowed with common sense, intelligence never surpassed, with the power of intellect which enabled him to grapple with the most gigantic opponents in debate, developing abilities as a statesman which won the gratitude of his country and the admiration of the world, and with graces and amiability which drew to him all generous hearts, dies by the bullet of the assassin. But who was that assassin? Booth was nothing but the tool of the Jesuits. It was Rome who directed his arm after corrupting his heart and damning his soul. And after 20 years of constant and most difficult researches, I come fearlessly today before the American people to say and prove that the President, Abraham Lincoln, was assassinated by the priests and the Jesuits of Rome. In the book of the testimonies given in the prosecution of the assassination of Lincoln, published by Ben Pittman, and in the two volumes of the trial of John Surratt in 1867, we have the legal and irrefutable proof that the plot of the assassins of Lincoln was matured, if not started, in the house of Mary Surratt, 561 H Street, Washington, D.C. The sworn testimonies show that it was the common rendezvous of priests of Washington. What does the presence of so many priests in that house reveal to the world? No man of common sense who knows anything about the priests of Rome can doubt that they were the advisors, the counselors, the very soul of that infernal plot. Those priests who were both the personal friends and the father confessors of Booth, John Surratt, Mrs. Surratt, and Miss Surratt, could not be constantly there without knowing what was going on, particularly when we know that every one of those priests was a rabid rebel in heart. Every one of those priests knowing that his infallible Pope had called Jeff Davis his dear son and had taken the Southern Confederacy under his protection, was bound to believe that the most holy thing a man could do was to fight for the Southern cause by destroying those who were its enemies. Read the history of the assassination of Admiral Coligny, Henry III, Henry IV, and William the Tacitum by the hired assassins of the Jesuits. Compare them with the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and you will find that one resembles the other like two drops of water. You will understand that they all come from the same source, Rome. That arch rebel Jeff Davis could give the money, but the Jesuits alone could select the assassins, train them, and show them a crown of glory in heaven if they would kill the author of the bloodshed, the famous renegade and apostate, the enemy of the Pope and the Church, Lincoln. Who does not see the lessons given by the Jesuits to Booth? In their daily intercourse in Mary Surratt's house, when he reads those lines written by Booth a few hours before his death, quote, "I can never repent. God made me the instrument of his punishment," unquote. Compare these words with the doctrines and principles taught by the councils, the decrees of the Pope, and the laws of the Holy Inquisition, and you will find that the sentiments and belief of Booth flow from these principles as a river flows from its source. And that pious Miss Surratt, who the very next day after the murder of Lincoln said, without being rebuked, in the presence of several other witnesses, quote, "The death of Abraham Lincoln is no more than the death of any nigger in the army," unquote. Where did she get that maxim, if not from her church? Had not that church recently proclaimed, through the devoted Roman Catholic Judge Taney, in his Dred Scott decision, "The Negroes have no right which the white is bound to respect"? By bringing the president on a level with the lowest nigger, Rome was saying that he had no right even to his life, unquote. Right after Lincoln's death, John Surratt, who was part of the assassination conspiracy, fled to Montreal. From Montreal, he was taken to Liverpool, England, and then to Rome. When a United States official finally caught up with him, he was found in the Pope's personal army, a conspirator in the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Was a member of the Pope's personal army. Quote, "3 or 4 hours before Lincoln was murdered in Washington, the 14th of April, 1865, that murder was not only known by someone, but it was circulated and talked in the streets and in the houses of the priestly Romish town of St. Joseph, Minnesota. The fact is undeniable, the testimonies are unchallengeable, and there were no railroad nor telegraph communications nearer than 48 miles from St. Joseph. I'm sorry, 40 or 80 miles from St. Joseph. Mr. Lineman, who is a Roman Catholic, tells us that though he heard this from many in his store and in the streets, he does not remember the name of a single one who told him that. But if the memory of Mr. Lineman is so deficient on that subject, we can help him and tell him what was said with mathematical accuracy. The priests of St. Joseph were often visiting Washington and boarding, probably at Mrs. Surratt's. Those priests of Washington were in daily communication with their co-rebel priests of St. Joseph. They were intimate friends. There was no secret among them. The details of the murder, as the day selected for its commission, were as well known as among the priests of St. Joseph as they were among those of Washington. How could the priest conceal such a joyful event from their bosom friend, Mr. Lineman? He was their confidential man. He was their purveyor. He was their right-hand man among the faithful of St. Joseph. The priests of Rome knew and circulated the death of Lincoln 4 hours before its occurrence in their Roman Catholic town of St. Joseph, Minnesota. Okay, and I'm going to quick make a comment here. I happen to live in Minnesota. Yep, born and raised in Minneapolis here. And I haven't really been to St. Joseph, but I can only imagine. You know, Minneapolis, St. Paul is far more Roman Catholic than it's given credit for. And I'll just leave it at that. And we'll get back to the book here. There is so much more material. Quote, In the trial of John Surratt, a French minister by the name of Rufus King stated this, quote, "I believe that he, John Surratt, is protected by the clergy and that the murder is the result of a deep-laid plot, not only against the life of President Lincoln, but against the existence of this republic. As we are aware that the priesthood and royalty are and always have been opposed to liberty," unquote. Burke McCarty, The Suppressed Truth About the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Four people were tried, convicted, and executed by hanging for the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Their names were David Harold, Lewis Payne, George Assardot, and Mary E. Surratt. They were all Roman Catholics. That information is in Ford's Theater in several glass cases showing many things about Lincoln, the Civil War, and his assassination. As Abraham Lincoln was being assassinated, an attempt was also made to assassinate William Seward, the Secretary of State. There was also to be an attempt on the life of Ulysses S. Grant, but Grant had to take an emergency trip to New Jersey to be at the bedside of a dying relative. Andrew Johnson, the Vice President of the United States, was also to be assassinated at this time. The man who was to kill him became scared and ran off, riding on a horse into the country, and did not carry out his part of the plan. Quote, Lewis Payne, known as a Florida boy, an athletic young giant, who some months before had joined the conspiracy, rode up to the front of the residence of the Secretary of State, William Seward. William Seward had been ill for 3 weeks, suffering from a fractured jaw, the result of a running away of his team, and was under the constant care of male nurses. Payne rang the doorbell, and it was answered by the colored butler. He told the latter that he had been sent with some medicine, which he must take to the sick room. The butler refused to allow him to enter, saying that he had orders to allow no one to Mr. Seward's room. The stranger, Lewis Payne, after a short struggle, knocked him down and went bounding up the stairs. He rushed into the sick chamber after felling each of the two sons of the secretary. He, Lewis Payne, then sprang upon the sick man and seriously stabbed him 3 times. By a superhuman effort, the latter struggled out of the bed with his assailant, who left him in a heap on the floor, bleeding from the wounds he had inflicted. After his murderous assault on Seward, a ruffian rushed down the stairs, yelling at the top of his voice, "I am mad! I am mad!" And he very probably was. He was entirely under the control of the hypnotic influences of the wicked people in those in whose power he had allowed himself to be, unquote. Quote, "It was part of the plan that Michael O'Loughlin, one of the conspirators from Baltimore, was to have murdered General Grant that night. This was not possible, owing to the change in the general's plans. To Assardot, it fell to assassinate Vice President Johnson, but he became frightened and spent the day riding into the country on a horse. He was found several days after with relatives of his below Washington. He made a written confession before he was executed, which confirmed the presence of Surratt in Washington that fatal day, a fact which 9 reputable witnesses had sworn to," unquote. Thus, we have a conspiracy to kill not only the president, but to bring the government of the United States completely into chaos. Do we not see the fulfillment of the Council of Vienna and Verona at work in 1865? Do we not see the hand of the Jesuit order and the Roman Catholic Church to destroy this great country? It was an awful time in the history of the United States. We have already seen that the Roman Catholic Church sowed the seed of division between the two great sections of this country, dividing North from South on the burning question of slavery. Quote, that division was her golden opportunity to crush one by the other and reign over the bloody ruins of both, a favored long-standing policy. She hoped that the hour of her supreme triumph over this continent was come. She ordered the Emperor of France to be ready with an army in Mexico, ready to support the South, and she bade all Roman Catholics to enroll themselves under the banners of slavery by joining themselves to the Democratic Party. Unquote. Charles Chiniquy, 50 years in the Church of Rome. Abraham Lincoln said to Charles Chiniquy, quote, I will be forever grateful for the warning words you have addressed to me about the dangers ahead to my life from Rome. I know they are not imaginary dangers. If I were fighting against a Protestant South as a nation, there would be no danger of assassination. The nations who read the Bible fight bravely on the battlefield, but they do not assassinate their enemies. The Pope and the Jesuits, with their infernal Inquisition, are the only organized powers in the world which have recourse to the dagger of the assassin to murder those who they do not convince or who they cannot convince with their arguments, or conquer with the sword. Unfortunately, I feel more and more every day that it is not against the Americans of the South alone I am fighting. It is more against the Pope of Rome and his perfidious Jesuits and their blind and bloodthirsty slaves. As long as they hope to conquer the North, they will spare me, but the day we rout their armies, take their cities, and force them to submit, then it is my impression that the Jesuits, who are the principal rulers of the South, will do what they have almost invariably done in the past. The dagger or the pistol will do what the strong hands of the warriors could not achieve. This civil war seems to be nothing but a political affair to those who do not see, as I do, the secret springs of that terrible drama. But it is more a religious than a civil war. It is Rome who wants to rule and degrade the North, as she has ruled and degraded the South from the very day of its discovery. There are only very few of the Southern leaders who are not more or less under the influence of the Jesuits through their wives, family relations, and their friends. Several members of the family of Jeff Davis belong to the Church of Rome. But it is very certain that if the American people could learn what I know of the fierce hatred of the priests of Rome against our institutions, our schools, our most sacred rights, and our so dearly bought liberties, they would drive them away tomorrow from among us, or they would shoot them as traitors. But you are the only one to whom I reveal these sad secrets, for I know that you learned them before me. The history of these last 1,000 years tells us that wherever the Church of Rome is not a dagger to pierce the bosom of a free nation, she is a stone to her neck to paralyze her and prevent her advance in the ways of civilization, science, intelligence, happiness, and liberty, unquote. Lincoln said, quote, "This war would never have been possible without the sinister influence of the Jesuits. We owe it to Popery that we now see our land reddened with the blood of her noblest sons. I pity the priests, the bishops, and the monks of Rome in the United States when the people realize that they are in great part responsible for the tears and the bloodshed in this war," unquote. Quote, "You are perfectly correct when you say it was to detach the Roman Catholics who have enthralled themselves in our army. Since the publication of that, the Pope's letter, a great number of them have deserted their banners and turned traitor. It is true also that Meade has remained with us and gained the bloody battle of Gettysburg. But how could he lose it when he was surrounded by such heroes as Howard, Reynolds, Buford, Wadsworth, Cutler, Slocum, Sickles, Hancock, Barnes, etc.? But it is evident that his Romanism superseded his patriotism after the battle. He let the army of Lee escape when he could easily have cut his retreat and forced him to surrender after losing nearly half his soldiers in the last 3 days' carnage. When Meade was to order the pursuit after the battle, a stranger came in haste to the headquarters, and that stranger was a disguised Jesuit. After 10 minutes' conversation with him, Meade made such arrangements for the pursuit of the enemy that he escaped almost untouched with the loss of only 2 guns. Unquote. Lincoln said, quote, "The common people see and hear the big, noisy wheels of the Southern Confederacy's cars. They call them Jeff Davis, Lee, Toombs, Brogard, Semmes, etc. And they honestly think that they are the motive power, the first cause of our troubles. But this is a mistake. The true motive power is secreted behind the thick walls of the Vatican, the colleges and schools of the Jesuits, the covenants of the nuns, and of the confessional boxes of Rome," unquote. In fulfilling the councils of Vienna, Verona, and Cherry, the Catholic Church divided the North and the South through their agent, John C. Calhoun. They sought to destroy the economy through Nicholas Biddle, and they used the poison cup and the assassin's bullet to assassinate and to attempt to assassinate a total of 5 presidents within a span of 25 years. They reddened American soil with the blood of thousands of American young men in the terrible Civil War. Oh, that we had the eyes to see that Rome never changes. What she did, she is still doing today. May God help us to understand the evil of the Roman papacy then and now. And that ends chapter 4 of The Secret Terrorists by Bill Hughes. And I will comment that This is some very, very provocative information about Abraham Lincoln that, honestly, I had no idea was the case. And, you know, I guess we got to really do our research here in America and look at some of this suppressed history that has been hidden from us and is no longer a part of our criteria for learning here in this country. And I highly, highly, highly recommend to anyone listening to this recording that if you have not checked out the reading of the book Rulers of Evil, read by Jörg Glismann of Belgium, that you ought to type in the search engine of YouTube, Joggler66, that's JOGGLER66, and find his channel and check out his reading of Rulers of Evil. It's just really, really an amazing recording, set of recordings he's done, and I've uploaded some of them to my channel. I intend to upload all of them. But I would highly recommend that people listen to that as well. I would like to take a quick moment to thank everyone that I know on YouTube, all of you. I'm very grateful for the work that you've done, and especially to Jörg Glismann of Belgium and Tom Friess there of Inquisition Update in his reading of the book Rome and Civil Liberty that he is currently working on. And I highly encourage everyone to check him out and also check out Jörg's show, The Hour of the Truth. And I was just recently on with Jörg just a couple days or a week ago. And I'm looking forward to doing more recordings on YouTube. I'd like to encourage others as well to get active with doing your own research and starting to read your Bible and getting to know your scriptures really well. I think it's really, really important that we all personally get to know our Bible really, really well, like the back of our hand. And we need to know the truth. We really, really do. And there is only one way to the truth. And that's why we need to really, really, really get with it and pray for the people that they can come to that knowledge and that they can find the knowledge of the truth and be born again, as hard as that is to do in this present day and age. All right, so on the topic of the secret terrorists, the next chapter is the sinking of the Titanic. And there are a couple of things, you know, it just hits me that these quotes that Lincoln made at the end of this chapter are, I mean, it's just such valuable information that's been lost. And you would think that we would be taught some of this history in our history classes. But of course, we never do. We never get taught any history about Roman Catholicism because it's religious. And, you know, isn't it interesting how the Roman Catholic Church uses Christianity in the absolutely worst way it could possibly use it and benefits from it politically. And I mean, it's just utterly disgusting. And wow, I mean, who would ever think? I would have never thought that things are really as bad as they are. But I encourage others to join me and our journey into the future here. And Thanks for listening. And I'll look forward to seeing you next time. And I hope you're doing great. And God bless you. Bye-bye.